Would everyone please take their seats, please, so we can begin? Good evening, and welcome to the annual American Legion Auxiliary Washington, D.C. Conference. We are honored to have the Joint Armed Forces Color Guard with us this evening, as well as veteran and Operation Encore performing artist Keith Broker to lead us in the singing of our national anthem. Then our National Americanism Chairman Kathy Dottestill will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. So please rise and remain standing for the opening ceremonies. Will the Joint Armed Forces Color Guard present the colors of our country?
Thank you.
Hand salute.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Please join me in repeating the preamble. The pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
On right shoulder, ho!
Will the color guard please retire the colors? Two. Our National Chaplain, Karen Baylor, will now offer the invocation.
Would you please bow your heads with me? God and Father, we praise you for this good land of ours, for the heritage which has come to us through the efforts of those to whom freedom, justice and righteousness meant more than life itself. Give us inspiration to meet the needs of the future. Thank you, Lord, for blessing our Legion family with faithful, wise, and energetic national leaders Mike Helm, Janet Jefford, and Mike Moss. Bless them with good health and happiness as they continue their year of leadership. Grant us wisdom to make right decisions, persistence to support them, and radiance that will win others to join with us in mission. Lord, as we meet our elected officials this week, we ask discernment not just in what we say, but how we say it. Please keep our hearts pure, our words succinct, and our mission foremost as we serve you, our veterans, and our military. We thank you, God, for being so good, and all your people said, amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Please join me in a moment of silence in honor of our fallen heroes. Please be seated. And I'd like to thank the Joint Armed Forces Color Guard for the presentation of the colors this evening. Serving you as your national president has afforded me so many opportunities to meet wonderful people living in the spirit of family, faith, and freedom. I am amazed at all our members do in order to honor the sacrifice of those who have served and are currently serving in our military. I am so excited to be here with you this evening for the opening ceremony of the American Legion Auxiliary's annual Washington, D.C. conference. Tonight, I hope, is sure to be an unforgettable evening, and I am so happy that you all took time to join with us and celebrate. As we spend the next few days in our nation's capital, let us remember that all American Legion Auxiliary members serve as veteran advocates and promote the American Legion's legislative program. We continue to serve as their troops and be a vital component of the American Legion family. So now, let's get on with the show for this evening. First, it is my honor to recognize some very important people in the Legion family. With the national officers of the American Legion, if you are here tonight, please stand and be recognized. Now, would all the American Legion Auxiliary National Officers please stand to be recognized? And I know we are privileged to have in our audience this evening some past National Commanders of the American Legion. Will you please stand and be recognized? And now, would the past national presidents of the American Legion Auxiliary please stand so we can recognize you. A big thank you and welcome to all the special guests that are here this evening. Our next very special guest was elected as the National Commander for the Sons of the American Legion in Charlotte, North Carolina, at the 43rd National Convention. SAL Commander Mike Moss lives in Colorado and is very active in his Colorado detachment. Mike's eligibility is through his father, a 54-year member of the American Legion family. Mike's father served in the Air Force during the Korean War, flying B-29s. Mike's motto this year is Building Bridges to the Future, and he is striving to have membership at 100% and the renewal rate at over 90% by May 1st, 2015. I hope he makes that goal. Please welcome, with your applause, your 2014-2015 Sons of the American Legion National Commander and my friend, Mike Moss.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, good evening, everyone, American Legion family. It's a pleasure to be here this evening. My Building Bridges to the Future this year is going to link our American Legion family together through membership and our help with our programs to become stronger. I would like to thank the American Legion Auxiliary for the fine job and everything you do for our veterans and our children and youth across our nation. Again, Madam President, thank you for inviting me here this evening. Hopefully, and all wishes to you to have a successful conference. And it's been a fun year so far. It's going fast, but Madam President, Commander Mike, it's going to be a great end of the year here. So let's start going and move out quickly. Again, thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
I'm going to say goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Also joining us on this special evening is the leader of the nation's largest veterans organization. Michael D. Helm of Kansas was elected national commander of the 2.4 million member American Legion during the 96th National Convention. A U.S. Army veteran during the Vietnam War, he served with the 82nd Airborne Division in Fort Bragg, North Carolina, and earned his Ranger tab in 1972. He has been a member of Jack Helt American Legion Post 313 in Nebraska since 1972. Commander Helm served as commander of the Department of Nebraska from 1987 to 1988 and as a national vice commander from 2003 to 2004. He also served as the national commander's representative to the National Legislative Commission, chairman of the National Veterans Affairs and Rehabilitation Commission, and the chairman of the Foreign Relations Commission. Commander Helm's wife, Debbie, is active in the American Legion Auxiliary, having served as District 9 president and as the department junior activities chairwoman. Debbie and Mike are parents to five Legion family members. Please welcome American Legion National Commander and my very good friend, Mike Helm.
Thanks. We ding that bell for you? There we go. Thank you very much for having me here tonight. And I just want to say what a great year we've had so far. And just to remind all of you that as I know that there's department presidents and other department officers out there that see their year coming to an end in the next 3 or 4 months. But keep in mind that Janet and I and Mike, we've got over 6 months to go yet. And all of you are a part of our year. And we want you to continue to be a part of our successes that we have. And so in my year as your national commander, we work the same projects every year and we make those same efforts every year. But in my program, I've wanted to include the whole American Legion family in what we do, and not only with our membership, but also in our fundraising, that we can do better if we work together. And so in membership, I want the auxiliary units, the Sons of the American Legion squadrons, and the American Legion Post come to that 100% American Legion membership within your American Legion family and your local communities. And then I've got a little ribbon to go on your flag that'll make a remembrance of that. And the same way with fundraising, I don't have a special fundraising project for the year, but I want us all to come together and address all the funds of the American Legion family. And over on the Legion side, we have Operation Comfort Warrior, we have the National Emergency Fund, we have the Child Welfare Foundation, we have temporary financial assistance, we have the Legacy Scholarship Fund, and then a brand new one out there called Soldier's Wish. And over on the auxiliary side, of course, we have the Auxiliary Emergency Fund, a couple of scholarships in the Auxiliary Foundation. And I want you to just give to American Legion Charities. And keep in mind that the charities that you give to, 100% of that money goes to that charity. There are no administrative costs like so many of the other charities that are out there. And both in membership and in fundraising, I want us to get to 4 million members and $4 million. And I think we can do that. There's 2.4 million Legionnaires, 800,000 auxiliary members, 3.5 million members of the Sons of the American Legion. And that's about 3.5, 3.6 million members in the organization. We get to the 100%, we can grow to 4 million. The same way with fundraising. We can raise $4 million for this great American Legion family. And I know we can do it. Fundraising, I know we're going to get there. We're already at over $2.6 million halfway through the year. We're probably on target. We're actually probably on target to hit $5 million in giving on the dollar side. The membership's going to be a challenge, but it's a challenge for each and every one of you. And I heard someone say today in one of our membership meetings that we get excited about that one person that signs 40 or 50 or 100 members into our organization. But the important person are the ones that go out there and get one member or two members. We need 1,000 of those. And that certainly does a lot more for our organization than those great winners. And no offense to them, great winners are great. But we individually each need to become involved in this great organization. So I talked about fundraising and I talked about membership. You heard me say the word four million several times. It's a 4x4 campaign, everybody. The four-wheel drive going down the road, all of our wheels going the same direction. The American Legion Auxiliary, the Sons of the American Legion, and the American Legion Riders. And if we all do this together, we're going to get there. I want to tell a real quick little story. My aide's out there somewhere. Where are you at, Don? Stand up. We didn't see him. But you know, early in my year as your national commander, we left Indianapolis, Indiana to go back to my state for a little thank you for the great job they did in my election as your national commander. And we got to the Indianapolis airport, and lo and behold, and you've all had this experience recently, the plane was canceled. And then the plane was delayed a couple of times. And finally, we got to Dallas-Fort Worth, and then we were delayed a couple more times. And so it was late at night, 10 or 11 o'clock, when we finally flew out of Dallas-Fort Worth into Grand Island, Nebraska. And we flew across Texas and Oklahoma and Kansas and into Nebraska. And as we flew along, it was a pretty dark night out there. Not a lot of people live out there anymore. But as I looked out there, I saw little clusters of light. And I soon realized that those clusters of light were American Legion post units, squadrons, and chapters doing their part for their community and for veterans. And I got to call on them my little campfires of service, campfires of caring, and campfires of freedom. And that's what each and every one of you are in your own local community. And I just ask for you to do your part in your community. And if you do, your community's going to be all right, America's going to be all right, and the American Legion family's going to be all right. Thank you very much. Tell them to sit back.
Sit down. Commander said, sit down.
We got things to do.
I just want to tell you, it has been such a joy so far serving with Commander Mike and Commander Mike. They have taken such good care of me along with the Commander's aide, Don, over there. And I am so happy that they are now part of my special memories and my American Legion family. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Janet.
Okay. As many of you know, a few months ago in New York City, the American Legion Auxiliary was honored by the organization Americans for the Arts. What a personal thrill it was for me to accept the Outstanding Contribution to the Arts Award on behalf of the Auxiliary. We are truly grateful for this recognition of our members' long-standing support for art therapy for our veterans. We are also very excited that through our ALA Call to Service Corps, the Auxiliary is working with America for the Arts Senior Director of Arts Policy, Marita Wester, to increase art therapy outreach to veterans. It was at this wonderful awards event that I had the pleasure of becoming acquainted with the person who presented the Americans for the Arts Award to the Auxiliary. American for the Arts board member and retired U.S. Army Brigadier General Nolan Bivens. And by the way, Nolan is a longstanding Legionnaire. After talking with General Bivens and learning more about the American for the Arts, I knew that I wanted to open our DC conference with a celebration of the transformative and healing power the arts hold for our veterans. With this focus in mind, we worked on getting special guests to our stage that would showcase different types of art therapy, including still life imaging, film, and performance arts. Once we had our presenters and performers on board, I realized we needed someone really special to help lead this on-stage experience tonight. We needed someone with a dual passion for veterans and for the arts. And I knew just the person. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please welcome to our stage Americans for the Arts board member, retired U.S. Army Brigadier General Nolan Bivens. So we're gonna do this together, huh?
Well, good evening. It's always great to be in the room with a fellow Legionnaires. Thank you so very much. As a retired general officer in the U.S. Army and also a board member of the Americans for the Arts, I have the distinct honor of serving as the co-chair on the National Advisory Council for the National Military and Health Initiative. And it's through that effort and that initiative that I became fully and gladly aware of the great contribution that the National Auxiliary has done in contribution to the art. And in the presentation of that award, I had the opportunity to meet your great president, and it was my pleasure and honor.
We had lots of fun.
So all over the country, organizations like the Auxiliary are helping veterans use the arts as a part of their healing form from both physical and psychological wounds. Let's now look at the film and video that was shown during the presentation of the awards and learn about some other stories of those great contributions and the important work that the Auxiliary is doing.
I wound up, after going to 5 wars in 10 years, suicidal. I was interrupted in the act, and I came home and began to get medical care. And what I found really helped me was writing. And I got control of all the traumatic memories in my life by writing about it.
For millennium, folks have gone to war and they've come back with wounds inside. And arts helps heal that. Arts can provide a medium for folks to express their feelings and begin that process of healing from war.
The American Legion Auxiliary has long promoted art as a means of therapy for our veterans. It gives veterans an opportunity to express themselves in a way that many of them never have been able to do or had the opportunity to do.
And so by painting, by creating sculpture, by writing, by using an instrument, these are ways to express the unexpressible, the unexplainable.
I can't tell you how many service members have said, "I've never talked about that before. I can't believe I just opened up about that." This was the platform for them to begin to discuss those traumatic experiences and then be able to do better in the rest of their care and as they move forward. And they're better able to communicate with their clinicians, their providers, their families, and that's life-changing.
The National Creative Arts Festival is actually a competition. It brings together veterans who submit artwork at their local VA facilities, and then the best are brought together at this one event.
I get by with a little help from my friend.
It brings healing in so many ways. The veterans, they are able to express and articulate what they may not be able to articulate in words. They do it through their art, and that brings about healing. Healing of the mind, spirit, soul, and body.
Every plump letter I received from Carolyn soothed my accumulating stress, and erased every grimy line on my face.
It allows me to be seen. It takes me from the inside to the outside, and I become part of the world again, which is part of my healing from traumatic stress.
Veterans come from every community, and they'll serve, and then they'll go back to those communities. And while there may not be a VA in many of these places, there almost certainly is an American Legion. There's almost certainly a local community arts organization.
There's a sorrow in the wind, blowing down the road I've been.
Now, with this partnership with American for the Arts, we can take the experience of the American Legion Auxiliary, pair that to the resources and the access of the VA, and connect that with the 3,000 community organizations that are out there. And so my hopes for the future are bright, that we'll see more paintings, more expression, and more of that great content from veterans.
A wide river to cross.
National President Janet, thank you so very much for inviting me to be a participant in this program. And now you get a chance to sit down and enjoy the program.
Okay.
Thank
Good
you.
Luck.
God bless you. Thank you. While today's American military has proven itself to be the best in the world, it does face urgent challenges, I think we all would admit. Since 2001, they have endured extended deployments and multiple deployments. Exposure to a non-traditional form of enemy in warfare, and shortened times at home between those deployments. The number of service members returning home from the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, suffering from such conditions as post-traumatic stress, loss of limbs, traumatic brain injury, and depression is increasing daily. The lives of these servicemen and women, their families, and their caregivers are in turn forever changed in face of their new reality. Through the work of Americans for the Arts and their partnerships with Walter Reed Army Medical Center, the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs, and countless other organizations, hospitals, and caregivers around the country, we are raising awareness that the arts increasingly play a crucial role in helping our nation's injured servicemen and women and their families to not only rehabilitate, but to flourish. Since only 1% of the country's population served in the military service, many in the civilian community do not have a familial connection with military service members and may not feel as connected with the military culture. This is why organizations like the American Legion Auxiliary are so crucial in helping to bridge that gap. And now, on my written script, this is the time I'm told I have the opportunity to go off script. So the adventure begins. No, not really. I did want to guide myself a little bit so I don't get too far off in the forest. As an infantryman, that's easy to do. But I thought tonight, in order to answer probably the million-dollar question that's in the room that I always get when I'm in gatherings like this is, what does an Army retired general, an infantryman at that, have to do with hanging out in the arts? When I thought about that question, I realized that it really probably is the venue for me to most express to you why I value the contribution that the National Auxiliary Organization is making, as well as the Americans for the Arts, and to this contribution of veterans, now one myself. So where did the journey begin? You know, sometimes you have those experiences where you experience one or two things, and then probably somewhere later in life, another one comes together and you realize why it all happened. So my journey actually started at the Darnell Medical Center at Fort Hood, Texas. I was the deputy commanding general at Fort Hood, and in the throes of returning from war and preparing a division to go back to war, I had to go in and do my normal physical. You guys know about that, right? So I went down to the hospital to do that physical. And in the process of doing the hearing test, the young lieutenant that was administering it to me looked at me towards the end of the test and said, "Hey, sir, can I ask you a question?" I said, "Sure, feel free." She said, "I'd like to share with you a story of some of the things that I'm experiencing here in the hearing test with some of our young men and women, service members that are returning from combat in Iraq and Afghanistan." And what she began to express to me, and I'll be short and brief, is how when she starts administering the test to these individuals, she'd get in the middle of it, and all of a sudden, they would not be sending those signals back out, like, "I hear what you're saying," you know? And she'd get up to go look, and she'd look inside of the booth, and what she would see oftentimes is service members weeping and crying. Obviously, she got the general's attention. I didn't know this is what she was trying to do, but she did. And I said, "Okay, so what happened?" She said, "Well, as I confer with them and talk with them, I find out that somehow sitting in this quiet, silent booth, they began to reflect on some pretty traumatic experiences. Now they're away from the parades that brought them back in great glory and celebrating their contribution. They're away from the family member great reunions that have occurred. And sitting in that silent booth, it all comes back." And she said, "The reason I asked you this is I wanted to know what should I be doing to help them." And I immediately said, "Obviously, you need to refer them to the right mental health and other resources that we have to assist them." Needless to say, my life as a general was changed that day, and I went back to preparing to go to war again. 5 years later, I was in Iraq, and another story kind of comes to mind. And this is maybe a little disconnected to some of what we're talking about in terms of healing, but I realized that we could not win the wars that we were facing, like most individuals, the way that we had done in the past. This was a new conflict, a new type of war, and we need innovation and creativity in our young men and women to deal with this. And one Marine platoon showed that. They were in a village, and there was a funeral happening, and they were patrolling, and obviously animosity was high. So this young Marine sergeant was faced with, how do I not escalate this any further by our presence in the midst of this funeral, the procession? And he said the only thing he could think about creatively, and this is where I'm going with this, is I'll take a knee, because in my culture, when you want to show respect, you do that. But I maintained my security and awareness of what was going on around me. And it immediately smoothed the situation over. So fast forward now, a couple of years later, I'm back in America and down in the Southern Hemisphere, and I'm in the process of transitioning from the military, and I had an opportunity to go to a transition dinner at Fort Belvoir. And at that meeting, I had the chance to have dinner with President and CEO of Americans for the Art, Robert Lynch. And Bob asked me a very simple question that night, and in comments of talking, he said, "I'd like to figure out ways for the arts to be more contributory to our young men and women that are returning." And he said, "What do you think we might be able to do there?" Still on active duty, I thought about it. But as I reflected, those two incidents came back to my mind. Shorten the story, years later now, I'm retired, back in the area, Bob and I connect, and I began to see that there was a great opportunity for the arts to be very, very helpful, because the reason that the individuals in that Darnell health hearing booth did not want to come forward because they were afraid that they may get some stigma attached to them if they went formally and made it aware that they had these challenges. So arts create those alternative ways to do that without that stigma. It's a venue that they could get in and take advantage of. And I thought that I'd like to be a part of helping that to occur. But also, the young Marine demonstrated that there's innovative thinking and creativity that we need to give our young leaders, and I think that's another aspect of what I'd like to be involved in as well. And so with that as a transition, tonight we have to acknowledge the innovation of the visual artist Benjamin Patton. Ben oversees all aspects of operations for Patton Veterans Project a nonprofit organization established to benefit servicemen and women and military families coping with the effects of post-traumatic stress. Through the organizations I was there, filmmaking workshops, recovering veterans collaborate to conceive and produce short films and help them make sense of the traumatic and overwhelming experiences associated with their deployment and transition home in a safe, therapeutic, and healing way. And this is the point of the connection to the story, is that I read here earlier that we're talking about bridges to the future. And the point I realized was that I could be a bridge to the future just as you are envisioning for your organization. And just as the work Ben is doing, it's bridging the military, the experiences of our servicemen and women and veterans with the help and the rest of our American community that wants to help them. To date, they have helped more than 100 veterans express themselves through nearly 50 films. The youngest grandson of World War II's General George S. Patton Jr., Ben is co-author of Growing Up Patton, Reflections on Heroes, History, and Family Wisdom. Please welcome to the stage Mr. Ben Patton.
First of all, I just want to say thank you very, very much for coming tonight. I know we've had some bad weather, but delighted that all of you are here. And thank you to President Jefford and the commanders, Mike, Commander Helm, Commander Helm and Commander Mike, and Commander Moss and General Bivens. And it's such a pleasure to be here. I would say thank you to everyone else that's of rank, but I know one thing is for sure: I'm the lowest ranking person in the room. So I'll just say. say that to cover myself. But most of all, I want to, I know people make, there's even been a book called Thank You for Your Service that somewhat lampoons that idea of thanking our veterans for their service. I think it's not the whole story, it's just the beginning. But I do want to say as a beneficiary of several generations of military service, to say thank you to the veterans and the members of the military families in this room and everybody associated with the American Legion and the American Legion Auxiliary that for me, these kinds of events where we were able to gather here, whether it's on a holiday or July 4th or Veterans Day or Memorial Day or an event like this, are not the only days that we're supposed to say thank you to our veterans. They're simply signposts to remind us to thank them every day and to do everything we can to pay them back. And that goes for those of us associated with military families as well. Our job begins there. So I just wanted to acknowledge that and say, again, thank you for coming. I'm very lucky to be a member of this family. It's famous for some there's things it's famous for. There's some things that it's infamous for, but I certainly descended from several generations of people that of a heritage that really ate, drank, and slept military service. Many of you all may know of my grandfather, but my father is really my hero and the one who's the subject of my book. There's another hero in my midst here that I'll introduce in a moment, but my father was a division commander and a major general. We actually lived at Fort Hood. They lived there twice, and he commanded 2nd Armored Division. And I remember him at one time saying, he said he couldn't drive past a piece of ground on the way to the movies or church with his wife without figuring out a way to attack it. So this is the kind of world I grew up in. He said he could think of little else. And it's a funny remark when I tell people that because, I get a laugh out of audiences, but in the context of what we're going to talk about tonight, it's actually rather serious, and it's one of those questions I never had a chance to ask my father. How did you deal with that? I mean, there's a quote from the famous Chinese war historian strategist Sun Tzu, which is in time of peace, prepare for war. But there's another half to it, which is in time of war, prepare for peace. And I think one of the things that we always need to do a better job of is helping our veterans and our military families learn to create peace. And I think it's a valid question, and I think this theme of the Legion and the Auxiliary this year, and hopefully ongoing, is art as a healer, is critical and perhaps long overdue. So I think that's really the focus. I know several of the people that were featured in that the video, Ron Capps and Melissa Walker, and they're all doing the same thing. And there can never be enough of us. So I wanted to divert for a second and speak briefly of a hero that I have that's in the room here. The American Legion obviously has been around for a century, but my mother, Joanne Patton, I'm not going to say how long she's been around, but she's been around my entire life. And we had our own sort of American Legion right in the household. And she's a descendant, maybe not quite as well known, her half of the family, perhaps, but generations of West Pointers going back from her brother to the class of 1812, including both of her grandfathers being chiefs of the U.S. Cavalry and her great-grandfather being a Medal of Honor recipient, and helped set up the Army Community Services in 1968 as a mother of five kids and one with special needs, my older brother. And I just want to say, I'm going to tell a story about you in a second, so I just wanted to acknowledge you as one of my great heroes. Our father passed away 10 years ago, but she's here. And I am a little nervous tonight, but I think by saying that, maybe that'll make me less nervous. So I'll just say that again. I'm a little nervous, and I should be. This is an auspicious crowd here, and hopefully no hecklers in the back. But I wanted to just, I'm trying to connect the dots on a few things, and eventually I'll show you a couple of films to give you a sense of what we're doing. But I want to tell a brief story, probably badly, about my mother, and she'll correct me later. We're staying in the hotel watching the Oscars later. So, but in 1953, she was 1952-53, she was a new bride. My father was off to Korea. I don't think she had had the first of five children yet, my older sister. And obviously, in the afterglow of World War II, every time she showed someone her ID card, she would get the question, "Are you related to the great General George S. Patton?" And I think after getting this question quite a number of times and having enough to deal with as a new bride and about to be a mother, at one point I think she was at a social function and she replied to someone that knew her name. She said no. And as I recall, someone, and again, I'm certainly embellishing the story. You're welcome to pop up anytime, but someone behind her that was a veteran and knew her said, you know. He said, "What you did just then was very selfish, really, by not sort of acknowledging that relationship with this history through your husband. You're really taking away an opportunity for somebody to share something, perhaps that they may be holding in for years, and maybe this sometimes different people are touchstones for different experiences. And in this case, he said, you know, you're doing a disservice." And I will say that from that day on, not only did my mom's attitude change, but our standing orders essentially were when someone asked us if we were related to either General Patton, that the answer was to be something along the lines of, "Yes, did you know him?" and again, sort of a lighthearted sort of remark, but if you think about it, the next thing we were told to do was just shut up and just listen. And I've experienced that because what we do as an organization, and I'll tell you a bit more about it in a moment, starts with listening. And that's what your job starts with too. As veterans, as dependents, and hardly dependents, I mean, that's probably a misnomer. We know who runs the family in our, you know, the Patton household, I can tell you that. But those were our standing orders, and it really does start with listening and affirming and validating a story. And that kind of brings me to sort of introduction to my own work, and that is around the subject of communicating. Human beings are listening and communicating. Human beings are storytellers. It's part of what makes us human and distinct from the rest of the animal kingdom. Since the, you know, 30,000 years ago, Paleolithic man drawing hieroglyphics on the walls of caves in France that they recently discovered. Caves, I should add, that had no other purpose except to have those pictures adorn the walls. They weren't places where people lived. I mean, there's a need, a compulsion to tell our story to somebody. Maybe it's ourselves, maybe it's our family, maybe it's Tom Brokaw, whoever it is. But there's a compulsion to pass that on, to say, hey, I killed a bison today, I fed my family, I was here, I mattered. Now, the way we do that is what's changed to a great extent. And that is, you know, I can just speak from my own experience. I wrote a book about my father a couple of years ago, and there's a whole section there about his correspondence with his father. They hardly saw each other during World War II, but they corresponded weekly. And in my mother's marriage to my father, when he was away in multiple deployments, three in Vietnam and one in Korea, as we got into the late 60s, it shifted from letters to audio to reel to reel, and then audio cassettes. Well, today's veteran communicates often just as much, but in a different way. Facebook, Instagram, you all know it, Skyping, and so forth, Snapchat. And when we look at these current wars, the ones that are on the verge of completing, the OEF and OIF veterans, the average age is about 27. So this is their world. This is the medium that they understand already and use ubiquitously. And it's a very, very powerful medium. I would say the video camera is about the most powerful means of communication ever developed. And they use that. And so this is, you know, we're the heart of who we're dealing with. It doesn't have to be just them, but the heart of who we've been dealing with as an organization is essentially the YouTube generation of veterans, the YouTube generation of warriors and their families. And we're meeting them in their world, and they appreciate it. So about 3 years ago, I formed this organization, the Patton Veterans Project. I'm pleased to say that we've progressed a little bit from what may have been a dated biography that I gave. We've now worked with about 500 veterans and several military families, and they've made close to 250 films. And essentially, we're leveraging off that communications device to meet these soldiers where they are, as I said. And we all know the statistics, you know, PTSD, hundreds of thousands, homelessness, suicide. I was recently talking to someone at the NMFA a few days ago, the National Military Family Association, and they're lobbying Congress to track a new statistic, and it's a frightening statistic, and that is suicides among spouses and the children of veterans. The fact that we even have to consider tracking that is frightening in itself. But our particular approach to dealing with veterans through video started, and I think it's important to mention this, with a conversation I had with a journalist named Bob Woodruff, who's very much a humanitarian, very much a veterans advocate, and he himself was embedded I think it was the 4th Infantry Division in late 2005 and had about half of his head blown off and has a porcelain skull, and he started a wonderful foundation with his wife. And we had an interesting conversation where he said, you know, when I had my the traumatic brain injury I had and the post-traumatic stress that went along with it and the thousands of soldiers that we've dealt with or veterans that we've dealt with, he said there was a certain need just for me to unpack a lot of these colliding anxieties that I had and repack them, maybe throw some out, put some on the top shelf, and reorganize them in such a way. And that was really the epiphany that I personally had was the idea that this is what editing is. You take a lot of different kinds of material and you put it together on a timeline, you manipulate the time-space continuum, and you tell a particular story to a particular audience. And I just think as a background, that's for I Was There film workshops, that's very important to say, because I was there means I was there, but it doesn't mean I have to be in my film, it doesn't mean I have to have even people in my film. I could be behind the camera. It's about empowering the veteran to tell the story or show the story, I should say, any way they want. I'm delighted, frankly, to have somebody in the audience, Pam Truitt and her husband Bob, both veterans, both spouses. How about that? Both veterans and spouses. And Pam actually, and I wanted to get my facts straight tonight. I was gonna lean over and make sure I had my facts straight on something, but because you know we know about some of that issue lately, but we did a workshop with Pam at Fort Belvoir a couple of years ago, and if I recall correctly, the Monday morning we started was the same day as the Navy Yard shootings 10 miles away. And a couple people just dipped out. Pam stayed. She was, you know, like a lot of veterans, very touchy about anything relating, especially something that was called I Was There, about relating an experience to anybody, particularly some, you know, civilian and other civilian instructors. But 4 days later, I think at the beginning you wouldn't even shake my hand and say hi, but 4 days later she introduced her film. She worked with a couple of other veterans on it. It had to do with a very tricky issue dealing with assault and things related to that. And then came back just a few weeks ago and was a mentor at a future workshop. So I would just say that, you know, the transformative power of film is right here in front of us. So I want to show you a couple of examples of what we do. We basically go to military bases. We're working at 7 bases, about 5 or 6 regularly, mostly the 18th Airborne Corps bases, because one of our key advisors is the Corps commander. We're just expanding to 1st Corps in the next few months. Possibly, if things work out, the Navy SEALs are a possibility abroad, and ultimately to military families and civilians. So I want to show you a couple examples of what we do. And let me emphasize that we've seen, you know, Ron Capps and others in these wonderful photographs here. The trick is you kind of have to find out what people respond to. Fortunately, film encompasses a lot of them. We have many films that are made with no video at all. They're just still photographs. Some with G.I. Joes, where a person said, I got a lot to say, but I'm not going to be in a film. And it's incredible to see what power you can convey through these different kinds of metaphors. So I'm going to show you two films. They're both very short. This first one contains some combat footage. It was done early in our existence, about maybe two and a half years ago. Primarily, in this case, by one soldier, partly because we were very small and we had trouble getting people to fill the classrooms initially, but a very powerful film with another couple of soldiers assisting and myself, and it was a guy that came in out of multiple deployments infantry with the 4th Infantry Division, and he said, look, I said, what's the purpose of your film and who do you want to speak to? And he said, the purpose of my audience is my family. He was just about to get married, and he had some kids, and she had some kids, and they were just blending them together. And he said, I want my wife and my family to know that they have no idea what I went through in Iraq and Afghanistan. They don't have a clue. And the second thing I want to tell them, hand in hand with that, is that I couldn't have survived without them. So take a look at this film, and we'll talk about it for a second afterwards. If anybody is activated by combat footage, just be aware of that, but it's just a couple minutes long, made in 3 afternoons, and you tell me if it works. So this is called Through My Eyes.
Hello? Yeah, I can stop and pick some stuff up, babe. Yeah, I'm at the commissary already. All right, love you, and I'll see you in a little bit. Bye. My family.
Yeah.
So, you know, very simple film. Very simple, made in 3 afternoons, maybe 12 hours worth of work. And I remember going back to a next workshop we did. This was at Fort Carson, where we've done 6 workshops. And I remember seeing his then, he was married a little while after the workshop, and I got to meet her. And she said, yes, I really had no idea that this is what he experienced. Now, that shocked me a little bit, frankly, because as I recall, and my mother may remember differently, but we were pretty open in our family about talking, at least so I thought, about a lot of these experiences. It was pretty much, you know, breakfast chat or talking about military experiences, although maybe not, as I reflect on it. I gave a talk a while ago, and my brother, of all people, one of the first times I ever spoke in public, was in the back and said, do you think our father ever suffered from PTSD? And so there could have been, you know, I've come to think about that a little bit more, but and whether or not he had, there were certain things he hid that he couldn't talk about. And so anyway, but Bryce Shepherd here and the veteran that he worked with, who's the guy who was in the footage inside the commissary because he didn't want to be in the commissary, very significant. And he stayed in touch. It's another guy who did not want to have anything to do with Ben Patton when he walked in or any of the civilian, male and female civilian instructors. But 4 days later, he had an opportunity to share something. And I think this brings me to there's a few benefits to this process. One is that I also have a developmental psychology background, and we've been tracking the PTSD and depression symptoms as we go along, before, after, and 30 and 60 days. And we're finding that at about a 20% reduction in PTSD symptoms just over the course of the 4 days. How to consolidate that, how to extend the engagement with the veteran and filter that into other therapy that they're doing, perhaps that's something we're working on. But we've seen a lot of positive result of it of this. And I think one thing that I can't remember if it was General Bivens that mentioned it, but there is a real problem right now among veterans associated with stigma. And really something like along the lines of half of the veterans that are entitled to mental health benefits don't even seek them out because it's just. There's too much they would have to face, and it's some cases it has to do with the machismo of their unit, or you know, it's not cool. But and at the same time, we see this alarming suicide rate, not just among OEF OIF vets, but among Vietnam vets too. So anyway, these are just little different ways I could branch off, but this is just to give you a sense of one example. Now let me show you something. I would say not the other end of the spectrum. We've had all kinds of films, music videos, rap videos, videos with cartoon characters, even Buzz Lightyear and Barbie, but making very profound points. But this next one I want to show you is kind of the direction we're going. We just did we've done 30 of these workshops, and with 500 soldiers, 500 veterans, inner branch, mostly Army though. And November we had a chance to go to a retreat out in Bluemont, Virginia called the Boulder Crest Retreat. I don't know if anyone has heard of it. But it's a wonderful place where they have cabins for veterans to come with their families. And so they allowed us to do a workshop sponsored by the USO with military families. And we mostly had families that had done our work, where the soldier had done our workshop previously. This is one family that was at that workshop. And I don't want to give you a lot of introduction, but this was made over the course of the Thanksgiving week by the entire family. And I think it's very relevant to the kinds of things that this organization or these organizations are focused on this year and hopefully going forward. So have a look at this. It's called The Call. And again, it was made in about 3 afternoons with everybody, by everybody that you see in the film, supported by civilian instructors, and we always have a clinician on hand.
Daddy comes back safely. I really, really don't want Daddy to go.
Please, God, keep John safe from all harm, physically, mentally, and emotionally. And please keep this family strong until he's brought back home to us.
It's too soon.
I didn't sign up to be a single parent.
We didn't have enough time.
You're never here for me.
You're never here.
So let me pose a question and feel free to just shout out. Do you see that as a positive film or more of a negative film about this issue? Anyone? The truth. Okay, but does it strike you as kind of having a, does it feel, you know, more cautionary tale or a positive? What's your gut feeling?
Both.
Well, most people would look at that and say that it's got a negative lilt to it for obvious reasons. I want to just say a couple reasons why I think it's really should be seen as a positive film, and it takes the context to understand that. And first of all, this veteran has already been deployed multiple times. He's come back. He's never going to go to war again. He's a Navy diver, lives in Virginia Beach, lesions on the brain, schizophrenia, has a service dog. Really, he's having some struggles. He's waiting for his med board rating. I think he just got his med board ratings a couple weeks ago. But here's why it's positive, okay? And this is really important. And that is because this film is about conversations that a lot of veterans, I use the term soldiers loosely, but a lot of veterans don't have, okay? But in order for this family to make this movie, they had to have those conversations. So that was what was happening the several days before they completed this film. I mean, they had their son, Archer, whose birthday was that weekend, was like doing multiple takes to make sure he got it right. We had conversations with Haven, the other daughter, where we had group conversations, different combinations of the people there, of the several families, and she was saying how she never wanted to tell her dad that how she felt, that she was so worried about him, because he didn't want him to be less effective at his job. You know, and we know about veterans that don't want to tell their kids about what they see and do for all the reasons we know. And then the wife who's in many cases, people often have referred to the wives, the spouses, as the ones that are deployed often. Because they, in fact, we had a whole movie about that, where two guys sitting in an airport and they're chatting about their wives and how they're deployed. But then we find out they're in an airport in Bagram Air Base getting ready to go home. So that's why I see this as a positive, that this is kind of what a lot of these different artistic endeavors allow, but particularly film is a very powerful one. It's collaborative. It's very hard to make a film by yourself. And a lot of the veterans that are coming back, particularly to these transitional care facilities, or the ones that just have so many layers of paint over the top of their history, they can't even think about it, like many Vietnam vets. But the collaborative aspect is the antidote to that sense of isolation that nobody can understand. And you break the ice, and then they leave often friends. And with a family, the family dynamic can work that way too. And this is just one example of how this medium can really unlock things in people. And for the kids, my God, I've got a five-year-old, and he's like begging for my password. You know, he knows how to run all my apps on my iPhone and everything. And so they're already there. The next generation even more so. So that's kind of what I want you to understand about what we're doing, but only as an example of what so many organizations are doing. I think if there's one thing that's lacking, it's collaboration. which is, you know, our motto is listen, collaborate, empower. And I think collaboration is the one where many people are hurting. There's 40 or 50, at least 40,000 NGOs in the veteran space, and a lot of us don't know how to work together. I happen to have collaborated with Ron Capps once on a workshop here, but I mean, that's something I'd love to see more of. And I think I'd like to leave you with a couple of ideas. One is, once again, just to say thank you, not on Veterans Day or July 4th, but just like this is just another day here, February 22nd, and I just want to say thank you to all of you who have missed a meal or heard a shot fired in anger or loves and knows someone that does. And but I also want to again repeat that that's not enough. Even for those, whether there were spouses, sons and daughters of veterans, grandparents of veterans, you know, any combination of anyone who's connected to a veteran, we need to be thinking about new ways to help those people that helped us every day. And I think this is one that is valid and self-evident to a great extent, and we're in the process of proving its value. And I would throw it out there, and I will admit right here to now that I have not been an active with the American Legion or the Auxiliary, but that's going to change today, because every day we wake up, we have a chance to change our path. And it's going to change first thing tomorrow, shall we say. But I would love to throw it out there to you all. I would love to have an opportunity to collaborate with the American Legion, with the American Legion Auxiliary. I know a lot of facilities that are all over. We have one in Hamilton, Massachusetts that I've gone to a number of times. And there are wonderful facilities out there. There's an enthusiastic population. There's a hell of a lot to do. And imagine, just I'll leave you this final thought, imagine that the military is the point of the spear on so many things in the Defense Department, you know, the internet, the, you know, GPS, obviously in a physical sense. But imagine if this can work for a military sexual trauma survivor, or it can be valuable for somebody that's seen some things that they don't ever want to talk about, why wouldn't it help? I mean, I was in New York when the bombings happened, and I was in just outside of Boston during the marathon bombings. And, you know, why wouldn't it work for the rest of us? And as we see these really hundreds of thousands of veterans and families moving away from military bases, and then think of the National Guard that never had them really to begin with in a certain sense, moving to civilian communities, what better way than to meet them with yet another therapeutic intervention. So thank you very much for letting me be here, and I'm happy to take a question or two, or I'll be here afterwards as well. Thanks so much.
Wow. Wow, that's great, great stuff. Ben, thank you so very much for taking the time and sharing your experiences and what you're doing to help out veterans. And join me once again for a great round of applause for Ben and his organization. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Well, I guess through collaboration, we can continue to build some more bridges, right, to the future. That's outstanding. Well, we all know that veterans aren't, as we often sometimes depict it, someone who is on a street corner with a sign, or someone who has PTSD or drinking problem. Veterans are our brothers, sisters, mothers, and fathers. And many of them also happen to be talented musicians with stories to tell as well. It's that sentiment which led us to the creation, which led to the creation of Operation Encore. It's a veteran music project that brought singers and songwriters together to put their military experience to song and verse. The result of the project was a compilation CD produced earlier this month, featuring songwriters and performed by active duty service members, veterans, and a military spouse. The project founders, two of whom are Legionnaires, say the goal was to not only provide a therapeutic outlet for the performers, but also to help bridge the civilian-military relationship within our country. In January, Operation Encore put out an open call for veterans and military musicians from all over to send in song submissions for consideration to include in this CD. The only requirement was that the song submission be at least inspired, if not based upon, and experience in the military. Here with us this evening, we have the pleasure of their performance, live performance, from some of the Operation Encore featured artists. Please put your hands together for Operation Encore.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction. And thank you so much to the American Legion Auxiliary for having us here tonight. What an amazing event and amazing venue. Thank you so much. The folks we have here with us tonight are some of the artists from Operation Encore. Like was just mentioned, it's only just over a year before we started to execute on what became this great compilation of veteran artists, singers, songwriters, talented musicians. A couple of buddies of mine from the service, from the Air Force, thought it might be a good idea if we could get folks together around music, because that was always so fundamental and important in our lives, in our time at home with our friends and family, and more importantly, our times deployed, when we were on the road, when things sometimes were the best and sometimes were the hardest. And we thought there were probably some other folks out there that were like us, and we were lucky and we found a few. So I don't want to talk for very long. I want to get you guys an opportunity to listen to some of these great folks, but I wanted to start by taking an opportunity and introducing the folks that we have here tonight. On bass tonight, we have Steve Speck Speckard, Jerry Maniscalco, Teresa D'Onofri, Steve Wilson, Rachel Hill, Keith Broker, and Tom T-Bone Abbott. They're going to play their songs for you tonight. I really hope you enjoy them. They're all written by them. They're going to play a couple songs by the folks that aren't with us here tonight, but are also original Operation Encore members. And without further ado, I want to get started for you. Thanks so much for having us.
Well, good evening, everybody. As Eric was kind enough to mention, by the way, a round of applause for my buddy Eric Bryan, who's one of the guys who really put this whole thing together. So the first song we're going to play is called To the Air, and it's by one of the guys who can't be with us. He's actually in Korea right now, serving away from his family. But this is a song about kind of the heritage we all have as former and some of us current military members. It starts with the Revolutionary War and works its way all the way up through Vietnam and Korea, too, if you listen to the lyrics. Very neat song. It's called To the Air. Ready? Two. I was on a hill in Massachusetts on the line. I fought in the militia in the bloody Great Divide. We made it to the front, another doughboy with a gun. Fighting in the trenches, everyone. We crossed the beaches with the shells all raining down. I froze in the Ardennes, watched them circling all around. And jumped into the night, traces lighting up the sky. I hit the ground and met them on the line. To the air, son, fighting on for everyone. Battles were raging on many miles away. The air, my boy, will carry you back home again. We'll be celebrating when you're walking through the door. Sent the Pacific in the spring of 42. I manned a gun at Midway when they sunk the Soryu. Fighting in the fog, 100 miles from the shore, buried in the sea forevermore. We cleared the deck and launched a nose into the wind. I rolled in on a zero and I put him in a spin. We took the beach shell with a fire all around, taking back the ground. Yeah, we put him in the ground. To the sea, my boy. Sailing to the blood and tour, a beam of foreign shore many miles away. Calmer seas, carry them back home again. We'll be celebrating when you're walking through the door. Thank you.
in the mud, you've done your time, fighting with a better kind and battered from the war. You've gone too long. Oh, when you're coming home again, oh, we'll be celebrating when you're walking through the door. Skies above are done and send me hell. I fought inside a fortress in a turret ball of hell. I flew me galley with a saber at my hand, and I fought the river valley Vietnam. Drink to your comrades, your country and your kin. A toast to all the fallen, all the ones who packed it in. See them in the next world, all where we all should be. Cause all the best are flying west to sea. To the air, son, fighting on for everyone. Battles are raging on many miles away. The air, my boy, will carry you back home again. We'll be celebrating when you're walking through the door. To the air, son, to the sea, my boy, to the battle line. Fighting with a better kind, and we'll be celebrating when you're walking through the door. Yeah, we'll be celebrating when you're walking through the door.
Thanks so much. Next up, Rachel Hill, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Third fret?
Hi, I'm Rachel. And I've never served in the military, but I am a veteran military spouse.
Woo-hoo!
Yeah.
I don't have a pick.
You got right behind you.
Thank you. I've been married for 13 and a half years. My husband's in the Air Force, and we've been traveling around. He's been flying A-10s, now he's flying the A-29 Super Tucano at Moody Air Force Base. And the song I'm gonna sing for you is a song that I wrote for him on our 10th anniversary. And it's called Another Trip Around the Sun.
Trip one, our fairy tale began. Trip two, you're in Afghanistan. I'm praying for your baby. Get back to me as fast as you can. Trip three, our baby's on the way. Trip four, it's just me and you. We're learning how to love through the worst times too. But I can't wait to take another trip around the sun with you. Swim above our skies, hey, we'll be all right. Gonna wrap my arms around you and hold on tight. Spinning through the universe, exciting new adventure. Oh, same old, same. Nowhere else I'd rather be. You know it's true. I can't wait to take another trip around the sun with you. Trip five, on to Tucson. Trip six, we're having too much fun. She's a little bundle of joy, and her daddy's troubles have just begun. Trip seven, it's time to go again. Trip eight, will it ever sell? I'm so tired and don't feel well. I'm sorry, I know that's no reason to yell. But I can't wait to take another trip around the sun with you. storms ahead or skies of blue, we'll be all right. Gonna wrap my arms around you and hold on tight. Spinning through the universe, exciting new adventure, or same old same. Nowhere else I'd rather be. You know it's true. I can't wait to take another trip around the sun with you. It's trip 9 and we're praying for someone we both love, but it isn't looking good. It's trip 10 and I'm lying here with my best friend, thinking of all the trials that our loves withstood. I can't wait to take another trip around the sun with you. Storms ahead or skies are blue, we'll be all right. Gonna wrap my arms around you and hold on tight. Spinning through the universe, exciting new adventure, or same old same. Nowhere else I'd rather be, you know it's true. I can't wait to take another trip around the sun with you. Let's go spinning through the universe, exciting new adventure, all same, all same. Nowhere else I'd rather be, you know it's true. I can't wait to take another trip around the sun with you. Another trip around the sun with you.
Thank you.
Rachel Hill.
Well, I'm very fortunate in that I get to do a song that's by a good friend of mine named Stephen Cavell from Northern California. And we both have a strange background of both having been in the 82nd Airborne Division. And I can't tell you what this song is about. You're going to have to listen to the words, but it's based on his experience in Iraq, and I think you'll catch it. It's called Sand Hills to Sandals.
Feet back in my favorite sandals, feel so good I can hardly handle. I got this green grass feet all to myself. Just hours ago was a world away, but I'll leave those thoughts for another day. My temper's shorter, at least I still got my health. And try as I might, I can't escape it. Burning fields and nights spent awakened, listening to the thunder we pulled down. 'Cause it's a lifetime. Every day you wake up on the front line, creeps up like a shadow deep in the night. And tell yourself it's alright and turn out the light. Sun feels bright, joyous and warm. Your friends tell tall tales in your honor by round after round at the corner bar. But what about the boys for the empty seats? The ones who you barely got a chance to meet. They gave it all for something. Will they get a glass too?
try as I might, my words do no justice. The stories I tell seem so pointless. Classic case of you had to be there, 'cause it's a lifetime knowing someone's baby's walking the line, creeping through the shadows deep in the night, making sure it's all right for me to sing all these silly little words for you to it's hard not to with the things I've seen, but I've made my choices and my peace long ago. And in this lifetime, you can take the world's sadness as a sure sign to teach each of our children to take the long side and fight the good fight.
Thank you so very much.
Out on the line. Out on the line.
All right. That was Steve Wilson. We're going to do a song by a guy named Chris Couric, who was an F-16 pilot with Speck and I. Great guy. Couldn't be here tonight. He apologizes. By the way, thank you all for what you do. We really appreciate it. This is a song about being out on the line. Ready? One, two. One, two, three. Time was upon us, boys. I never mess with a lot of noise. Cut out the whitewashed chores and find the mess we're in. Find your friends and settle up. Grab a drink and fill your cup. Up in time, this is matter what, we'll take our licks. Don't look back, we got you six. The problems here that you can't fix are the only ones you found. Just take your time and do it right. Make it through another night. Thank you, that for Chris Currick. Well, we kind of went out of order there, so we're going to do another song. This one actually is by me. I wrote this song about flying A-10s in the original Gulf War back in 1991. So, let's see if we can make this happen. Ready? One, two, one, two, three, four. Sitting in the desert sun, for three long weeks since the war's been done. Everything covered in the fine, fine sand. A million miles away from the promised land. Drinking Haji Quibble from a plastic jar. Banging out rhythms on an old guitar. Say we're going home, but they don't say when. Nothing left to do but to rise again. Brotherhood, gunfire, joy and pain. Just trying to explain and drive a man insane. But I'd do it all again if they ask me to. What the hell kind of man would do the things we do? I remember sitting in the desert sun. 10 long years since the war's been won. And time just slipped away like a fine, fine sand. A million miles further to the pro. Thank you.
Cold steel roaring.
I'm gonna try to do some slide guitar here. Don't laugh. Ready?
Giddy up.
Continues beating, but my lungs can't find the air. I wrap my empty arms around me to hold what's left inside. It's like the world's torn me open. I cast my soul aside in the cold steel rain falling from the sky. Can't get through to you, but I'll never let it go. It's like a ball and chain pulling me down. I reach for the surface, but I don't know where to go. Baby, all this time, you've given me the best of me. I wish I knew the way to give you all the rest of me. And underneath the cold steel rain, you walked away. Pieces of the mess that I left behind. And your eyes can't hide all the damage that you try so hard to hide. Grab your empty arms around you and you went against the pain. In your heart you make another promise that you know you're gonna break again. And the cold steel rain falling from the sky can't get through to you, but I'll never let it go. Like a ball and chain pulling me down. I reach for the surface, but I don't know where to go. Baby, all this time you've always had the best of me. I wish I knew the way to give you all the rest of me. And underneath the cold steel rain, you walked away. The rain comes down, the world looks all brand new. And as the rain comes down, I wanna wash all your pain away. And as the rain comes down, let it take the pain from you. And the cold steel rain falling from the sky can't get through to you, but I'll never let it go. Like a ball and chain, and it's pulling me down. I reach for the surface, but I don't know where to go. Baby, all this time, you've always had the best of me. I wish I knew the way to give you all the rest of me. And underneath the cold steel rain, you walked away.
Thank you.
Steve Wilson.
Nicely done.
All right.
You guys having fun?
And this is just the start of it, right? This is just the beginning.
All right. Well,
I'm Teresa D'Onofri. I'm active duty on the E3 AWACS, and I am the token ukulele player on as part of Operation Encore, as well as mostly the E3 community. And this was a simple original I wrote for my relationship at the time, to where I wanted to make it a point to where, hey, if I'm not able to speak with you, whether it was Skype, email, some sort of message, he could listen to my voice and fall asleep to that and dream of me, so that way it would reduce the time apart. So this is your lullaby. Baby, oh baby, tonight I know, yeah, I know I'm not the only one who's hurting tonight.
So this is a song called One More Day. It's by our friend Matt Stake. He's one of the guys who can't be with us this evening. He wasn't able to travel this far. But this is one of my favorite songs, basically, because it's about him contemplating stealing an aircraft to fly back to his lady friend. But other than that, it's a very enjoyable song, too.
3. Sorry. We knew there was going to be one of those. I have a lot of equipment changes, harmonicas and stuff.
Let's see.
Stole my harmonica.
How does it go?
Oh, yeah, that one.
That one.
You know, we got it.
He only has to play all of the songs, so it's, you know.
We come from all over the country, and we've played with each other 3 times. Once in the studio.
This is number 3.
Oh,
thank you.
No. I'm
no
not
excuses,
making excuses.
No excuses.
No excuses. I suck. Here we go. 1, 2, 3.
Sitting on a Ponce train, ice cold beers and hand grenades, sweating in the sun without her here. Sleep a little blonde, wrapped in sheets, dreams about a man, and I hope it's me, 1,000 miles away in Ohio. And I know she'd fly if I could only pay her way. The rent don't grow on trees, and we have bills to pay. I got a half a mind to steal a jet and fly myself back home. If I did, I'd probably get lost anyway. Yeah. I better stay here in New Orleans one more day.
That's right.
The singing man makes his way, paying homage to the day he got his first guitar and learned to play. Me, I'd rather sing about the one I wrap my arms around, and I think it's safe to say that she'd do the same. And I know she'd fly if I could only pay her way. But rent don't grow on trees, we have bills to pay. I got a half a mile to steal a jet and fly myself back home. If I did, I'd probably get lost anyway, yeah. I better stay here in New Orleans one more day.
Mr. T-Bone Abbott on the guitar, ladies and gentlemen.
I know she'll be waiting when I pull in that drive, in a sundress blowing in the wind. It drives her crazy when I take my time. You know I never wanna leave that girl again. Sitting on Lake Pontchartrain, ice cold beers and hand grenades, sweating in the sun without her here.
Sorry about that beginning, guys. I suck.
Jerry's waking up.
Oh.
Like, I can't sit down for this one. I gotta stand up. My name is Jerry Maniscalco. I'm the only Navy guy in the bunch.
Oh,
apparently not.
And we still let him play with us.
I didn't understand that, but I'll ask you later.
Because you're so much better.
We got an Army guy. Come on, man. We got an Army guy.
This is a song I wrote on the ship. I'm also one of the active duty guys here, too. I'm an instructor down at Whiting Field teaching guys how to fly helicopters. So that's fun. But every once in a while, you walk out and you're like, man, I really love my job. And this is a song along those lines. It's called Wake Up. Feel free to clap now. Come on.
Punch out of your
inside your head, retired deep inside your mind, and all the dreams we thought were dead are alive and well, alive and well.
Jerry Maniscalco.
Now you know why we let the Navy play with us. That boy's good.
We're going to bring Keith Broker back on up for one of his songs.
I haven't missed a capo change.
So this is a song called Late November. It was not written in November. It's a song basically about the uncertainty of rekindling a romance after long separation. Deployments and stuff, of course, always factor into that. This was written in college, though, as I walked past the apartment of a girl I had been kind of on and off dating, and I'm like, I should call
her. There
were
a lot
again.
Of those for him.
All right, ready?
Silent fortress, soldier who's lost the will to fight. Innocence in talking, some things just never turn out right. And so he just keeps on walking, she sees his figures fade into the night. She says, why can't you remember? Can't you see that something just ain't right? We don't need to spend our lives together, but maybe just tonight. Yeah. So she puts her head down as he turns around. She can't stop thinking, should he stop to talk? He wonders. It's just that it's so late, he's been drinking. She don't know what to do without him. He sees him turn around and turns on the light. Hears his footsteps in the hallway. She opens up her door and prays she's right. She says, why can't you remember? Can't you see that something just ain't right? We don't need to spend our lives together, maybe just tonight. All right. Ooh, yeah. Right. Seems we never were in late November. Back in
fire.
How are we doing on time? We have two more songs, but we could do one. We were given 45 minutes, I think. Have we run over? Where's Laura? She's in charge. She told me if I went over, there'd be hell to pay.
Exact words.
So we're trying to avoid eye contact with her.
Actually, if you'd seen Laura, hell to pay doesn't sound so bad.
Let's go with We Are.
Huh? We are. All right, we're going to do our last song here. This is also by Jerry Maniscalco and includes everyone on some harmonies towards the end.
We're going to bring the whole group up here.
Thanks again for having us out, and thanks for what you do.
Thank you very much.
It took us about 2 or 3 days to get us all here through various and sundry airlines and
as
overnights.
As I'm sure
and
all of you got to deal with as well.
As it happened to all of you, I'm sure. Some of us are jump seating home tomorrow. We're airline guys now, and it's going to be a challenge, but sure was worth coming out and playing for you. Thanks a lot.
She drives the same streets every day. Never wonders why they're all the same. But these painted lines from easy times mislead her fragile mind. She can't stay between the lines, but she tries. Oh, she tries. He reads the same news every day. Stories ever change, but these headlines with familiar storylines only feature different names. He can't read between the lines, but he tries. Oh, he tries. The children dream of things that we long forgot. Puppets dance in this fairy tale land. Could it be that far from home to make this dream our own? We will, yeah. And learn to love. Are we strong enough to make this dream our own? We are. Oh, we are. The stone builder rejected. We are the hope of one another. We are holding up each other. We are trying.
We're Operation Encore. Thank you very much.
American Legion Auxiliary, thank you so much. You guys are a phenomenal crowd. We appreciate everything you do. We appreciate the support you give us, the men and women that serve our nation. We're Operation Encore, and we're music with a message. We're not just veterans. We're not just servicemen and women. We're mothers and fathers, brothers and sisters. We're the banker down the street, the school teacher. Sometimes we're rock stars. But we're veterans, and we're here for each other, because if we're not, nobody else is. Thank you very much. We will have some CDs in the back. We're happy to have you come by and see us. All our artists will be back there to say hi to you on the way out. Thanks so much. Thanks, sir.
What a great show. Join me again in a round of applause for the Operation Encore.
Thank you so much.
Great performance and extremely talented. This time I would ask Ben Patton and our President Janet to come back up on stage and join us in our closing. Thank you so very much.
I'd like to first recognize two very special guests in the audience. Americans for the Arts Senior Director of Art Policy, Marita Wester, and the CEO and President of the Americans for the Arts, Mr. Bob Lynch. It was such a pleasure for me and National Secretary Dubby to meet Bob at the Americans for the Arts Awards in New York City. And Bob, we really appreciate the compelling Veterans Day article you wrote that was published in the Huffington Post, which included a wonderful mention of the American Legion Auxiliary and the importance of helping veterans through the healing powers of the arts. Would you and Marita please stand up and be recognized? Turn around. Okay, and while they're making their way to the back of the room, please join me in another round of applause for those wonderful performers and our veterans from Operation Encore. And to Ben Patton, thank you so much for being here. It has been great having you. And before we stop, though, you talked about your mom, but can you stand up, Mrs. Patton? And wave to everybody so they can see who you are. You know, Joanne's been a member of the American Legion for quite a while, American Legion Auxiliary, excuse me, for quite a while. And she showed me today that she follows us and she reads about us. And she said, I have my cross on for faith. I have my American Legion Auxiliary pin to show I'm part of the family. And freedom, we owe our freedom to people like your husband and General Patton for what they have done for us. Thank you so much. Ben's book, Growing Up Patton, will be on sale this evening, and he's agreed to stay and sign some copies for you. But you all know we had this trouble with the weather, right? So we only have about actually 25 books here this evening to be purchased that Ben will sign. But for others, if you want a book, we will ship them to your house at no extra charge, and Ben will be signing a specially made book plate for you. And when you get your book, you can insert that book plate, that signed book plate, in your book. And I'm supposed to tell you, only credit cards, please. Okay.
Chapter on my mom.
Oh, okay. Why won't you tell us about that?
I was just going to say there's a chapter on my mom.
It says here that for those of you who are unfamiliar with his book, Growing Up Patton explores the Patton family legacy and shares the inspirational wisdom that General Patton bestowed upon his only son through personal letters in which he dispensed advice on duty, heroism, and honor. In his book, General Patton shows himself to be a dynamic parent and a military commander. Okay, so thank you. Okay. General, it's been awesome having you here. Come here. And I want to thank you so much for being here this evening. And actually, I have some coins for both of you for this year. And it's celebrating our faith, family, freedom. So I'd like to give you one of my challenge coins.
Thank you, thank you very much. God bless you.
And before we close, I want to draw your attention to the beautiful art display that's around the room. All of these storyboards were provided by the nonprofit Veterans Art Project, an organization that takes artists who are also veterans and propels their artwork and careers into the mainstream creative arts community through networking, memberships, and collaboration with other professional artists. Veterans Art Project focuses on five disciplines: visual arts, performing arts, writing, film, and interactive media. They also provide high-quality, veteran-led professional services such as event and film production, documentation through video, and photo gallery exhibitions. Please take some time at the end of this event tonight to really appreciate these pieces of art. I guarantee they will move you. Again, thank you all for being here. I hope to see all of you tomorrow morning in the same room at 8:30. Have a great night, everybody. Thank you.